But I don't know how much we know about this great scholar. So today, insha'Allah ta'ala, we are going to discuss about... can we have that keyboard? Thank you. Jazakallah, khair al-jazak. Thank you very much. You want to change the slides? No, thank you very much. It's good. So, first of all, aims and objectives of these lectures. This series will be, inshallah, to shed light to the lives of our great scholars who had impact in shaping the Shia modern world. Who you are today as a good Shia is because of the scholars who have done great job before we were even born. So they shape the world in one way or the other. We will look at their biographies and their scholarly contributions. We will look at some of their thoughts and works in order to enrich our views and ideas. Some of their views will be controversials. They cannot be controversial because they are scholars. We are not. However, we may live in a world where we are used to some thoughts and ideas. So when we hear their views, sometimes we may be like, oh, what is this? I don't agree with, and so on and so forth. Which is good. It will make us to be able to think. So the feature of these lectures will be as follows. I will explore the life of each great scholar from a different part of the world. It could be Iran, it could be Iraq, it could be Pakistan, it could be Afghanistan, it could be Africa, maybe Europe, and so on and so forth. For each of these scholars, I will describe what kind of life they lived at their times, their scholarly lives, contributions, thoughts, and some of their works, inshallah. To introduce Sheikh Tusi, we understand that he was the leader of Shia scholars at his time. As we know, Mujtahid. Not only Mujtahid, he was a great marja of his time. He was one of the greatest Shia jurists. He was the compiler or one of compilers of hadith. He attained the station of ijtihad in both fiqh and usulul fiqh. Normally, our mujtahidina today, they reach to the highest level of education because of fiqh, Islamic law, Islamic jurisprudence. He was not only a mujtahid or marja in fiqh, but also in usulul fiqh. What's the difference between the two? Fiqh is Islamic law. When you want to pray, this is the way you perform your wudu. You want to marry, this is the way you recite nikah, and so on and so forth. Usulul fiqh will come to tell you the reasons. Where did you get this information from? And how did you come to say it is allowed, it's not allowed, according to the Quran, hadith, and so on and so forth. Sheikh was a marja of both fiqh and usul. From the four books of hadith, Sheikh Tusi is the author of both Al-Istibsar and Tahdhibul Ahkam. Let us make this lecture as an interactive. So we have four books of hadith. Every Shia needs to know these four books. Here two have been mentioned. Both are from Sheikh Tusi. Al-Istibsar and Tahdhibul Ahkam. What are the other two? Man la yahdhuru al-faqih is one, and al-kafi, sallallahu Muhammad wa ali Muhammad. Allahumma salli ala Muhammad. Very good. So al-kafi, man la yahdhuruhu al-faqih, al-istibsar and Tahdhibul Ahkam. These are what we call them. Al-Kutubul Arba'a, four books, four major books of hadith. You, me, and every one of us, we need to know. At least we need to go closer to these books. At least we need to touch them. At least we need to open and read them. If you talk to Ahlul Sunnah, They believe in 6 books of hadith. Sahih al-Bukhari, Sahih Muslim, Sunan at-Tirmidhi, Sunan Abi Dawud, Sunan Ibn Majah, and Sunan an-Nasa'i. These 6 for them are very important. They read them. Most of the time when they talk to you, they say, Rasulullah says this in Sahih al-Bukhari. What about you? What do you say about Shia? Can you say, for example, the way I pray my salah is because it has been mentioned in Al-Kafi, in Kitabu Salah, the 6 Imam has said and so. So it's very important for us, brothers and sisters. I want you to go out of your, what kind of zone you call it?
Comfort
zone, by depending on Maulanas and Mimbar and Majalis. No, you too need to go to the books. Take a book and say, I want to know my Imam, what did he say about wudu? What did he say? And then come talk to the scholars. Say, I have read in Kitabul Kafi, for example. Or I have read in Kitabul Istibsar in Tahdhibul Ahkam. It says this. What do you say? Then you develop yourself. And this is the importance of this series, inshallah. The ideas and works of Sheikh Tusi had overshadowed Shia scholarship, and no one opposed his opinions for quite a long time. Sheikh Tusi was that marja'a. There was no any other marja'a like him at his time. Not like today we have Said Sistani, we have Said Ali Khamenei, we have Sheikh Ishaq Fayyad, Bashir Najafi, and so on and so forth. Said Al-Hakim, he was alone. And he made his opinions to be like Quran. People wouldn't challenge him. Until later on, he died, he was gone. Then people started saying, but Sheikh Tusi was a human being. Maybe he made a mistake. His ijtihad maybe was wrong. Let us check again. But for quite a long time, his views and ideas was a final view. His works are unique resource for students and researchers of Islamic studies. If you want to do Islamic studies, you can't miss Sheikh Tusi in his work. In Arabic language, this is the way his name is written. Al-Sheikh At-Tusi, for students of Arabic. Students of Islamic studies. When you say Sheikh, you have to put alif and lam. Al-Sheikh. So, for example, you say Sheikh Fulan. But when you write, you have to put alif and lam. Why? Because this is a proper noun. If it is common noun, you say Sheikh. Which is known as Nakira and Ma'rifa. This is Ma'rifa. So since it is proper noun, say a Sheikh At-Tusi. His name was Muhammad bin Hassan bin Ali bin Hassan. Muhammad bin Hassan bin Ali bin Hassan. So he, Sheikh Tusi, is known as Tusi because he came from the area in Iran which was known as Tus. Which Imam came from, is buried there? Imam Ridha alayhi salam. Sallallahu Muhammad wa Allah. Sheikh Muhammad bin al-Hassan bin Ali bin al-Hassan was born in the year 385 AH after Hijrah, Islamic year. AD, it was 995 in Tus, in Iran. He was born 4 years after the demise of Sheikh Saduq. Inshallah, we'll come and talk about him too. Sheikh Tusi died in the year 460 AH. It was the year 1067 AD, and he died in Najaf and is buried in Najaf. I thought he lived in this world for 75 years. I'm not sure whether that is correct or not. For those people of mathematics. Yeah? 72?
75.
Okay.
75,
72?
Okay. According to your AD,
Sheikh,
no? The AD, yes.
No, I was taking 460, take away 385. 75. Okay. So how long did he live in this world? 75. Alhamdulillah, he lived for quite a long time. And from Tus, where he was born, he went to Baghdad. Sheikh Tusi grew up in Tus and began his studies there in year 1081 AD, which in Islamic is 408. He left Tus to study in Baghdad. He moved from Khorasan to Iraq at the age of 23 years of age here, where do you go? Maybe university? Yeah? Sheikh Tusi, at that time now, remember, he leaves his country, Iran. He goes to Iraq to study. This is after he studied under those scholars of his area. So, normally what they do when they go for these Hausa studies, like what he did, he went to Baghdad, because Baghdad at that time was a center of learning. So he had already finished recitation of the Holy Quran from Surah Al-Fatiha to Surah An-Nas. Ah, by the way, you remember we said, inshallah, every week we'll be doing the exercise of knowing the numbers of the surahs of the Holy Quran. You remember that? Sallallahu Muhammad wa Muhammad. Ahmad, where are you going, Ahmad? Okay. Fair, inshallah. So we said Surah number one is Al-Fatiha. And number two? Al-Baqarah. Number three? Al-Imran. Four? An-Nisa. Five? Al-Ma'idah. Six? No.
An'am.
You sure?
Yes.
You sure number six is Al-An'am?
Yes.
Correct. Number six Al-An'am. Seven?
Anfal.
No. A'raf. Eight?
Anfal.
Nine?
Tauba.
10?
Yunus.
11?
No.
11? Hud.
Okay, Yunus and then Hud. And then 12?
Yusuf.
13? No, Ra'ad. Ra'ad. Ibrahim is 14. 15 is Hijr. So let's take 15. If I come here next week, we'll do again, inshallah, this exercise. Surah number one again? Fatiha. Two? Baqarah. Three? Al-Imran. Four? An-Nisa. Five? Ma'idah. Six? Al-An'am. Seven? Al-A'raf. Eight? Al-Anfal. Nine? At-Tawbah or Bara'ah. 10? Yunus. 11? Hud. 12? Yusuf. 13? Ra'ad. 14? Ibrahim. 15? Hijr. Is this the Quran which we read daily? So we need to know it. Sallallahu Muhammad wa Muhammad. Allahumma salli ala Muhammad. I know because you're busy, you go work, you do this and that, maybe you don't get time. But inshallah, these exercises will make you better. Bi-ibnillahi ta'ala. So, Sheikh, he finished Quran, he finished Hadith, the beginner level. Now he is graduate. So he goes to Baghdad. Baghdad at that time, it was under the rulership of Bani Abbas. Bani Abbas, they brought all the scholars from different parts of the world to be in Baghdad. You want to know any science, call it Islamic science or any other science, Baghdad was the city of learning. It's like now today, you say I'm going to Cambridge or Oxford or anywhere else. Baghdad was that. So for you to study in Baghdad, it means that you are going to a fine place where there are fine scholars. Sheikh Tusi went there. He studied under many other leading scholars like Sheikh Al-Mufid. We'll come and learn about Sheikh Al-Mufid.
Can I just add something?
Yes, please. Thank you. Microphone, please. Another microphone, please, if you don't.
No, it's okay.
Continue.
Because we talked today about how we tend to glorify the past. But I just wanted to point something out about Baghdad around that time.
Uh-huh.
Baghdad, at that time, we're thinking Cambridge and Oxford were pioneers in education. But it is reported that in Baghdad at that time, there was around 150 hospitals.
155 hospitals in Baghdad.
Yeah, around that time there was that amount of hospitals. And not only hospitals, there were medical schools around that time.
So the hospitals were places of learning medicine as well.
Mm.
So when the kuffar or the people who are not Muslims say that Muslims were backwards, there was nothing like that in Europe.
Sure.
Hospitals with medical schools in Baghdad at that time.
Yeah.
Can you imagine, brothers and sisters? So enough about bragging about how civilized we were in the past, but just wanted to for you to know that that time in Baghdad, Muslims were way ahead of everyone else.
Thank you very much.
We've lost that glory, unfortunately.
Sallu ala Muhammad wa ali Muhammad. Allah sallu ala Muhammad wa ali Muhammad. So now today when you brag and say, well, I live in London, I take this from New York, and this one from Paris, and this and that, it's because you don't know your history. When you lose your history, you have lost yourself. If you don't know your history, you will be talking about other people's history. But what's your origin? So we need to know that there was a time, Baghdad, as we have heard, it was the center of learning. You talk about bridges, bridge. Bridge was something like a miracle in Europe, in America. But in those places, Baghdad and others, it was like something like you're making chapati. Yeah, easy to make. And so on and so forth. So science in those areas, it was like Muslims were the champions of that. So Baghdad was a leading center for Muslims. So he went to study under Sheikh Al-Mufid, Sharif Al-Murtada, Ibn Al-Ghadairi. These are leading scholars at that time. He gets the opportunity to learn under them. Sheikh Tusi has written many works, nearly in all fields of Islamic sciences, like tafsir of Quran, Islamic law, hadith, theology, and for his contribution and tremendous influence, he's received the honorable title of Sheikh Al-Ta'ifa. Sheikh Al-Ta'ifa, the chief or head of Shia. Not only Marja, not only Mujtahid, he's a Sheikh Al-Ta'ifa. I'm sure you have heard other people who are given title like Sheikh Al-Islam and so on and so forth. He was Sheikh Al-Ta'ifa. Why? Because of his many works, as we are going to see. His vast scholarship and learning made him a natural successor of Sharif Al-Murtada. Sharif Murtada, he was the leading scholar. When he passed away, Sheikh Tusi succeeded him. So impressive that the Khalifa of the time, Al-Qadir, who was Abbasid, not even follower of Ahlul Bayt, but because of knowledge of Sheikh Tusi, he used to come to attend the lectures of Sheikh Tusi. And Sheikh Tusi, at one time, he could teach 300 students. So you are talking about someone who was of high caliber. And in Baghdad, not any village, Baghdad. And anyone who comes to attend your lectures in this level, it means that they know Quran, they know tafsir, they want to hear something new, according to tafsir of the Holy Quran and so on and so forth. So Sheikh Tusi, remember, he came from where? Iran, Tus. So he wasn't an Arab, giving lectures in Arabic, talking to students who are in Baghdad. Arabic is not your language. It's not easy. But he managed to attract 300 students at one time. And the Khalifa attended his lectures. Unfortunately, in the 5th Islamic century, the political situation in Baghdad and the domains of the Abbasid Caliphate was in turmoil. Seljuks, a group of people who were anti-Shia, were gaining commanding power in the center of Islamic Empire, and they were going against another group who were known as Buyids or Buwaidids. I'm sure, Abdul Rauf, you remember Dr. Hussein now. Yeah? Jassy. Who were Shia sympathizers, Buyids or Buwaidids, were with the people who were Shias. But these Seljuks came and they were attacking the Shias. And they started in different places until they reached Baghdad. So, in the year Islamic 447, 1055 AD, the name of this leader, Tughril Bek, leaders of Seljuk, entered Baghdad. At this time, Many of the ulama in Baghdad, both Sunni and Shia, were killed. The killing which happened, it was because if you are Shia, you are dying. You are going to die. If you are Sunni, are you supporting the Shias or not? According to history, blood, you know, in Iraq you have two rivers, yeah? You have Euphrates and Tigris. Furat and Dijla and Furat. They were, people saw blood flowing in the rivers like the water flows normally. The rivers were filled with blood of people who were killed at that time. Sheikh Tusi was at that time in Baghdad. His house, the house of Sheikh Tusi, was burned down. He had many books, the books also were burned down. And these books he has written himself by his own hand. Let me take you back to the history. Today when we want to write, for example, this one, you type. It is there somewhere, you sent it by email. Or in the, what you call it, iClouds, yeah? And many other methods. Sheikh Tusi had to take ink and this pen, put it, you write it by your hand. And these books are very important books. They were burnt and he lost all of those books. Some historians, they say the rivers, Euphrates and Tigris, also, not only blood, the water changed to the color of the ink which people used to write, because most of these books were destroyed. Can you imagine how much science was destroyed there? So libraries was destroyed, house burned down, many people killed. It was a difficult moment for Sheikh Tusi to live there. So when he saw his house and library were burned down, and sectarian conflicts of that time, decline of Buyid dynasty, Sheikh Tusi moved to Najaf. There he established a Shia scholarly circle, which led to formation of Islamic Seminary of Najaf, which you know it today. Before Sheikh Tusi, Najaf was not Najaf as we know it today. It was Sheikh Tusi who established that Hausa of Najaf as we understand. So his contribution, Sheikh held study circles, he had many students as we saw, not only in Baghdad. When he moved to Najaf, Najaf became the intellectual and scientific center of Shia. Many studied there. However, some people say, no, Sheikh Tusi did not start the Najaf House of Najaf. There were other people who established the House of Najaf. Sheikh Tusi came to bring order and stability to the seminary of Najaf. Because why? Other people were there at that time. Now, when we look at his thoughts and intellectuals and religious position, we look at Sheikh Tusi as one of the leaders of intellectualism. Intellectualism in Baghdad, and followed the method of his teachers, Sayyid al-Murtada and Sheikh Mufidi, and perfected it. This school is known as School of Intellect or Madhab al-Aqli. Madhab School of Aqli is the one which says, can we read Quran? Yes, let's read Quran. Which surah? Fatiha. Let us read it. Can we do tafsir of surah Fatiha? Yes. Where can we find the tafsir? Hadith. You take the hadith, Bismillahir Rahmanir Rahim, in the name of Allah, the most beneficent, the most merciful. Alhamdulillahi Rabbil Alameen. All praise is due to Allah, Lord of the worlds. Where did you get that? From tafsir. Sheikh Tusi says, tafsir only on the basis of hadith is not enough. Maybe can help us, but we need to use our intellect. For example, Alhamdulillahi Rabbil Alameen. Rabbil Alameen. Rabb, Lord. Al-Alameena of all worlds. What are these worlds? Sheikh Tusi says now, if you talk about the worlds, you as a mufassir, you need to be a historian. You need to be a person who knows geography. When you say Rabbul Alameen, Allah is the Lord of all the worlds, how many worlds do we know? By the way, how many worlds do we know? Seven? What are those seven worlds? Jupiter, Saturn, Venus, those are three.
Mars.
Neptune, four. Mars, five. Uranus, and where do you live?
Earth.
Yes, the Earth. Yeah, Pluto, or maybe Poseidon. This is what the method of Sheikh Tusi. He says, when we say Rabbul Alameen, Allah is the Lord of all the worlds, you need at least to know those worlds. Don't just go to the hadith and say, okay, let me depend on this. He says, no, you live in this world, you need to make sure you know the world. And this science is your right, you as a Muslim. Don't leave these, for example, planets to be known by non-Muslims, and you as a Muslim, you don't know them. Which world are you living in? So Sheikh Tusi follows the Madhab school of intellect. And he says, Ijtihad and intellectualism in Shia fiqh and beliefs prevail among Shia due to the efforts of Sheikh Tusi, who ended the dominance of several centuries of Akhbarism. There were Shia who were known as Akhbari. Please underline the word. Akhbari. Who are the Akhbari? Akhbari are the people who follow Khabar. Khabar means hadith. You take Al-Kafi, Al-Istibsar, Man La Yahdhuru Al-Faqih, and Tahdhib Al-Ahkam. Any hadith you find there, you take it as it is. No discussion of intellect. Why? Because this is in the book of hadith. So because of this, many people forgot to follow their intellect. For example, some people, when they do Zanjir, you ask them, where did you get the view that Zanjir is allowed the way you do it? They may mention, for example, a story. There was one Sahaba who went to Medina to visit Rasulullah, and he didn't find him there. Rasulullah went to the battle of Uhud. And when he had Rasulullah was injured, and he lost his teeth, he decided to take a brick and hit his teeth to take it out. Yeah, and this is Waisil Karani. So, if I do now, today, I do like Sunnah of Rasulullah. Sheikh Tusi says, no, wait a minute. Rasulullah didn't take a brick to break his teeth. He was injured in a battle. You are not in a battle. Why are you doing this? Do you see the issues here? So the Akhbaris, they say, whatever we see in the book, take it like that. No tafsir. Sheikh Tusi says, no. You have to use your intellect. Because if you don't use your intellect, Islam will come to a standstill. So Sheikh Tusi used Madhabul of Aqil. He takes the hadith, the same hadith. He says, but let us look at the inner meanings of this hadith. What does it mean, really mean? And then you go around, you find different meanings. He says, this is Islam, which we need to look at it. His ideas in politics, he mentioned, this is the one which I say, it could be difficult for us to understand. He says, serving an unlawful government, in this instance, the Abbasid Caliphate, when he was asked the question, can we serve the government which is unlawful government? Abbasid came to power, it was the right of Ahlul Bayt. They didn't give it to Ahlul Bayt. Can we serve them? Can we work with that government? He said, is in certain circumstances desirable. But it is not obligatory. He says, yes, you can work with these governments sometimes. In some cases, it's not wajib, but you can work with. Sheikh Tusi, where did you get this from? Because this is very serious. He said, look, for example, at the time of Nabi Yusuf, alayhi salam. Nabi Yusuf was jailed. When he was in jail, prison, someone said, those two people who were with him, one was killed and another one was left free. Yeah? You remember the story. He told him, you are going to work with the government. Don't forget me. Remember me. Mention my name with the king. That person went and he mentioned the name of Nabi Yusuf, that he was jailed unlawfully. Nabi Yusuf was taken out of prison. Which government did he work with? The same government of the king who was not even a good Muslim. I don't know if he was a Muslim. Nabi Yusuf worked there. Why? Sheikh Tusi, you allow us to work with the government in certain circumstances? He said, yes, if you can help someone who is going his rights to be violated, if you can help him, help him. Don't just go there to be a rubber stamp. Everything is fine. But no, if you can help people and you don't spread corruption, work with that kind of a government. So now, question. You and me, now we are living in this country. Election is coming in December. Can we vote? But the government is not Islamic.
You have to follow the land rule, no?
If the rule of the land is against Islamic, what can we do?
Is it against the
law? I don't stop you from doing
I don't know. I don't know. If we choose the, let's say, whoever, MP, and then he goes and say, okay, from next year, no Islamic marriages.
We did talk about this in the next session.
Yeah, thank you very much.
And we say that our advice was to go with what's, I think it's obligatory upon us to go with what's beneficial for the Muslim community.
So what is beneficial for Muslims? Now you are thinking, now you are not applying any hadith there. Mm-hmm. You are not applying any ayah there. Because وَمَنْ لَمْ يَحْكُمْ بِمَا أَنْزَلَ اللَّهُ فَأُولَٰئِكَ هُمُ الْكَافِرُونَ. If you follow the rules of someone who doesn't apply Quranic teaching, he's a kafir. So are we supporting the kufr government? But it is here Sheikh Tusi says, no, there are some cases when it is lawful and desirable to work with the government which is unlawful. You see, the mas'ala is not easy, but he says, yes, you can do that. Okay, we continue. On economic and social and political fields, Sheikh Tusi succeeded in endowing imami law, meaning Shia law, with a structure and a scope of activity practically independent of the presence of the imam. What does it mean? There are some people who say, imam is in Khaybar. Imam here means Imam al-Mahdi. So, ajalallahu farajahu sharif. Allah masalah. Imam is in ghaiba. Can I be active in politics? Can I be active in social? Can I be active in political? Some people say, no. Don't do anything until when Imam, the whole Imam comes, then you can work. Sheikh Tusi, his work was to provide rationalist school, known as Usuliyya, with solid intellectual basis. He said, well, Imam is in Ghaiba, but on intellectual basis, what is your duty, you and me? Can we just sit back and say, okay, there's nothing we can do until the war of Imam? Or can we try to do something? So here, his importance was on emphasis on the rational dimension of religion. Rational. What our intellect can see. Can we say, no, let us not even collect khums or zakah and so on and so forth, leave it until the time of Imam? Sheikh Tusi says, no. We have to prepare the ground for the Imam. We have to do something. And because of this, many other scholars like Imam Khomeini, Rahmatullahi Alayh, later on they took these ideas and they said, we can form an Islamic government. Even if Imam is in Ghaiba. Because this is our wajib. So Sheikh Tusi started important developments in making Shia clerics to comprehend some of the roles permitted before, only for Imam. These were only for Imam, and Sheikh Tusi said we can do them. Like number one, to collect and distribute the religious taxes, zakah, khums. Can we collect them? Can we distribute them? Or can we wait until the Imam comes and he can do the job? You know, no, we can't wait. There was a time, unfortunately, when Imam was going to Ghaiba, even at the time of Imam Reba, some people say, this money which I have in my hand, of Khums is not mine. I cannot use it because it's haram. It's not mine. It's the mal of Imam. But Imam is in Ghaiba. Oh, Imam, we don't know where is he, who is Imam. They said the only thing we can do is dig like a grave, bury the money, put a sign there. If you die, when Imam comes, he will find the money. Wallahi, there was people like that. They said, we can't do anything. We can't eat this money, it's not ours. So, but we can't give it to the Imam, bury the money. Sheikh Tusi says, no, we can collect and distribute zakah and khums. Number two, organize the Friday prayers. Now we have amongst the Shias who say Salatul Jum'ah is not wajib. Don't pray until when Dhuhr Imam. Haven't you had this idea? Sheikh Tusi says, no, we can organize Friday prayers. We can listen to the khutbahs. We can collect funds and so on and so forth. These were his ideas. Now, on tafsir of the Holy Quran, writing commentary on Quran, Sheikh Tusi is the author of one tafsir which is very famous, is known as At-Tibyan fi Tafsir al-Quran, which was a model for later Shia commentary. It was the first complete commentary on the Quran written by a Shia alim at his time. And it includes all the chapters of the Quran, meaning 114 surahs. Before Sheikh Tusi, there were many scholars who wrote maybe tafsir of Surah Al-Jum'ah, tafsir of Surah Al-Baqarah, tafsir of these surahs. But Sheikh Tusi was the one who wrote the whole tafsir of the Holy Quran. Tibyan is distinguished from previous commentaries because in this book, Sheikh Tusi considered the opinions of other Shia and Sunni scholars. For example, we are talking about Arabic language. What is this scholar has said? It makes sense, you take it. Whether that scholar is a Sunni or Shia, Akhbari, and so on and so forth. Also, he benefited from pre-Islamic Arabic literature. Arabic literature, before the time of the Holy Prophet, there were many scholars who were good in Arabic. He took from them to understand the Holy Quran. This book is the first commentary of the Quran which compiles all aspects of Quranic sciences. And there are many Quranic sciences. Inshallah, if time will allow us, later on we may talk, not tonight, but in other lectures, inshallah. The most important feature of Sheikh Tusi's method in exegesis or tafsir was his ijtihad and intellectualism. Let us work hard to understand Islam, but use intellect there. He did not only depend on hadith only. No, he said hadith and how do we understand that? And Sheikh Tusi brought proof from the verses of the Quran. This underlined sets number two. He said Quran is an understandable text for human intellect. You can't say people will not be able to understand Quran. If you use your intellect, you can understand Quran properly. And it not take only the hadith. His works. In his book, which is known as Al-Fihrist, Sheikh Tusi Fihrist, he gives a list of 43 of his own books. His own books. He says, I wrote this book on this particular issue. This book on this, 43. Later on, people looked at the works. They came to know that he wrote over 50 works in different Islamic branch of knowledge. How many books? More than 50. How many have we written? How many articles we have written? When I say article, you know how to perform wudu. Can you write it and give it to other people when they come and say, you Shia, why you wipe your feet? Why you don't wash them? Say, okay, wait, let me write an article. Anytime you ask me, I'll give it to you. Have we done even an article? No. Sheikh Tusi wrote in philosophy, hadith, theology, biography, historiography, exegesis, and traditional law, foundation of law, rijal, replies to questions, and the best non-Shia books of hadith, which are four, we said Al-Kafi of Kulaini, who was in the 3rd century, Man La Yahdhuru Al-Faqih of Ibn Babawayhi As-Saduq, 4th century, Sheikh Tusi wrote these two, Al-Istibsar and Tadhibul Ahkam. When we say Al-Kutubul Arba'a, the four books of Hadith, these are the four books. Al-Kafi, Man-La Yahduru Al-Faqih, Al-Istibsar, and Tahdhib. Brothers, sisters, next time I meet with you, I will ask you about these four books. And you need to know them, inshallah. Sheikh 202, Istibsar and Tahdhib Al-Ahkam. This is Al-Istibsar. It is known as Al-Istibsar fi makhtalafa min al-akhbar or fi makhtulifa min al-akhbar. Ta'lif Shaykh al-Ta'ifa Abi Ja'far Muhammad bin al-Hasan al-Tusi. Al-Istibsar fi makhtulifa min al-akhbar. This compilation of hadith is one of the four books and one of the main sources of Shia fiqh. Tahdhib al-Ahkam, this hadith compilation is one of the four books. He has another book which is known as Misbah al-Muta'ajjid. This is one of the most important and reliable Shia sources for ritual practices, ziyarah, and prayers. When you go, for example, for ziyarah, they say, read Misbah al-Mutahajjid. Oh, it has been narrated from the book Misbah al-Mutahajjid. That is of Sheikh Tusi. Uddatul Usul. The first part of this book is about the principles of religion, and the second is about the principles of fiqh. Usulul Deen and Usulul Fiqh. Uddatul Usul, meaning Udda, means the tool which you need most of the time. Very important book. Then there is a book which is known as Al-Khilaf. This book is one of the first books in the sphere of comparative jurisprudence written by Tusi. He tries to collect all opinions of law schools of Islam in this book. This book also shows that there is a great accordance between Shia school of law and other schools. Sheikh Tusi, because he lived in Baghdad, there are Shias and Sunnis. He said, let me write a book. There are many ikhtilaf between Sunnis and Shia. Let me write one book. If you come and you ask me, what's the difference between Sunni and Shia on this issue, I'll give you the book. What is the name of the book? Yeah. Al-Khilaf, meaning differences of opinion between Sunnis and Shia. This book as a compendium not only rendered those opinions which Shia hold uniquely, but also conflicting Sunni opinions in much greater details. So mashallah, our scholars have done that. Today, our children, you too, you go to work, you go to college, you get problems. People asking you questions. There is a book, Al-Khilaf. Someone who speaks Arabic, go, borrow the book, say, okay, I don't know much, read this book. Al-Khilaf, Sheikh Tusi. Which century did he live? Did he live? 5th century or 4th century. So this is the book, Kitabul Khilaf. As you can see, the year of Sheikh Tusi, 385 to 460. Sheikh Tusi wrote it then, many years ago. The book is important now. His demise, his death, Sheikh Tusi lived for 12 years in Najaf and passed away on 22nd of Muharram in the year 460. According to Sheikh's will, he said, when I die, bury me in my house. Don't take me anywhere. In my house, dig a grave, bury me there. This house later on was converted to a mosque. So the grave of Sheikh Tusi is here, and the mosque near it. People come, they pray there. Sheikh Tusi Mosque, which is also called Jami'u Sheikh Tusi, is one of the most famous mosques in Najaf. It has been reconstructed and repaired several times and is used by professors, scholars of Islamic Seminary of Najaf as a place for holding their lecture. This is the mosque. Yeah, looks nice, yeah? Yeah. Yeah, so this is where Sheikh Tusi rahmatullahi alayh is buried. His legacy, the Seminar of Najaf Hawza of Najaf Hawza Ilmiya, founded by Sheikh Tusi, remains the top Shia theological institute in the world. If you want to become a scholar of Islamic studies, there are two places where you can study today to become a scholar. Najaf or Qum. Najaf in Iraq, Qum in Iran. In Najaf, one of the largest collection of Shia texts exists in library named after Tusi. Online, the largest repository of Shia digital e-books has been also labeled the Sheikh Tusi Digital Library. Both libraries are free for public use. Sheikh Tusi has got a lot of, mashallah, thawab. Conclusion. By my humble opinion, Sheikh Tusi, who lived more than 400 years ago, has made a big impact in the development of Shia scholastic. His influence can be felt until today due to his many books which he wrote in many different fields of Islamic sciences. The information I've given in this lecture is just an example of this great alim, who not only taught many students in his lifetime, but also he left behind a very useful library which any people get benefit out of it. Sheikh Tusi will always be remembered whenever the Hausa of Najaf is mentioned. We need to read his books and dedicate our times by studying and so on and so forth. You can fill the blanks. We need to read these books. We need to go closer to Sheikh Tusi by saying, I didn't know anything, now I know. When I was making this topic or lecture, I referred to some of the Arabic books. For example, this one of Agha Buzurg al-Tahrani, Tabakat A'lam al-Shia, Sheikh Tusi book, Al-Nihaya. The Cambridge History of Iran, Hamid Dabashi, Shiaism, Doctrines, Thought and Spirituality. Sayyid Akhtar Rizvi, who lived in Tanzania, his son is Sayyid Muhammad Rizvi of Toronto. The father wrote a book which is known as Prophecies about Occultation of Imam Mahdi alayhi salam, and is published by Bilal Muslim Mission of Tanzania. I visited a website which is known as wikishia.net. Also Wikipedia. So all this is to compile the information about Sheikh Tusi. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala have mercy on the soul and roh of Sheikh Tusi. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala resurrect him with Imam of our time, Al-Hujjah bin Hassan al-Mahdi ajalla Allah faraj. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala shower mercy on the grave of Sheikh Tusi. And may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala make our students to get benefit out of the knowledge of Sheikh Tusi, inshallah. The barakah of Sheikh Tusi and the dedication which he made in the development of Madhab of Ahlul Bayt. We ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, anyone or any person amongst us who is in difficulties by the position of Sheikh Tusi, Ya Allah, remove these calamities and problems. Ya Allah, we ask you to increase the love of Muhammad wa Ali Muhammad in our hearts. Ya Allah, have mercy on all our marhumin and those who have passed away. Make them, Ya Allah, enjoy this night by Surah Al-Mubarakah Al-Fatiha, which we are sending for their behalf. And but before that, Salat ala Muhammad wa Ali Muhammad. Thank you.